Complexes. I'm Meenakshi Devan from the India Sanitation Coalition. ISA's activities include forging partnerships with all the allied organizations for leading the discourse on sustainable sanitation, convening, curating, and disseminating best practices in the sanitation advocacy space, and providing input into the policy aspect of sanitation by participation in allied forums, as well as supporting the unlocking of WASH financing with a focus on corporates. Today's webinar is being organized under the joint aegis of the India Chapter of Sustainable Sanitation Alliance, SASANA, IRC, WaterAid India, and India Sanitation Coalition. I will briefly talk about the genesis of this webinar and the topic per se, O&M opportunities in rural community sanitary complexes. The Prime Minister's office launched Garib Kalyan Rozgar Abhiyan in June this year to boost the livelihood opportunities in rural India. It was a focus campaign of 125 days across 116 districts and 6 states to work in a mission mode to help migrant workers earn a livelihood opportunity, besides helping to create the durable infrastructure for a host of other purposes. Public works worth rupees 50,000 crore were proposed to be carried out under this Abhiyan. As a sub-element to the above initiative, we also knew that 75,000 rural community sanitary complexes or community toilets were going to be constructed, dovetailing the resources from the Ministry of Jal Shakti. As I speak to you today, many of these constructions have already been completed. Aligned to the above initiative also, Swachh Bharat mission shall also continue to support through the current mission, the construction of individual household latrines and community sanitary complexes so that no one is left out and any increase in population or number of households is also covered. However, there was a problem that I would say that the program managers missed to take into account the time at the time of the launch of the Garib Kalyan Yojana was about the operations and maintenance of these sanitary toilets. And this is something that I'd like to talk about and share the India Sanitation Coalition's perspective on it. One, O&M, the cost and financing and equity across and access and use of these community sanitary complexes are some of the critical elements that must be understood in the context and included in any framework that can be thought of for operating and maintaining these complexes. And two, while the cost of the individual household latrines has been retained at 12,000, the cost of CSC has been increased from 2 lakhs to 3 lakhs under the current provision under Swachh Bharat. This is significant besides another opinion which is gaining ground in the sector that potentially the private sector could suggest and support rapidly deployable and effective and resilient community toilet complexes which might be quickly constructed and easily maintained. I welcome that the government of India has gone ahead to support the construction of these complexes, yet there are opportunities around the operations and maintenance of these complexes where the private sector can step in to contribute, where support is needed to make India ODF sustainable. To discuss some of these and related issues, we have a very distinguished panel today, which is moderated by Ms. Padmaja Nair. Padmaja works as an independent consultant on social policy, planning and institutional development. With over 2 decades of experience, she has been involved in the planning and implementation of sector-wide programs in water and sanitation and urban development with a focus on slum development and urban poverty. She has participated in and led several evaluations, assessments and diagnostic studies on water and sanitation and urban development for multilateral agencies and has related publications to her credit. She has also worked in Bangladesh, Nepal, and Bhutan. With that, over to you, Padmaja.
Thank you, Meenakshi. Thank you. Good evening, everyone, and welcome to this very topical subject that the coalition has decided to take up today. And more so, I think the day is very, I wouldn't say auspicious, is very correct, right? Because it happens to be the World Toilet Day. And I think all of us are working towards the same objective. Before I introduce the three panelists for this evening, I'd just like to flag in some of the issues that we'd like to talk about. when we were talking about operation and maintenance of specifically community sanitation complexes, this is so different from if we were to talk about the IHL. I think all of us are very aware of that. Now, there are a couple of perspectives that we need to take into account when we consider O&M of community complexes. One to begin with is we need to differentiate firstly between community and public toilets, because this would then influence what is the kind of O&M that we need to undertake. The second and very pertinent question, which I think the background to this, the concept note that was circulated as part of this thematic discussion had also flagged, was that the very idea of community sanitary complexes, we need to understand who are the communities who actually require community complexes, is it really necessary, and then begin our designing and from there on the O&M processes from there. So the first and foremost thing that we need to add to any rural area that we go to is to try and understand, does that community actually need a community toilet? Are they ready to, willing to accept, and would they be using it? The rest of it, that is the design aspect, the technical aspect, the geographical aspect, whether it is a flood prone or a drought prone area, et cetera, would naturally follow. And all this would then influence the community, the O&M of the community toilets, and vice versa. So these are some of the issues we hope our panelists would be discussing today here, and then we would throw open, after the panelists make their brief presentation, we'll throw open the session for discussions. Unfortunately, I think we have very little time, and we already have received tons and tons of questions that we'll try to address as much as possible. So without delay, I would quickly like to introduce the panelists. There are three panelists, all of them with years and years of experience and varied kind of experience. Our first panelist is Mr. Debendu Sarkar, who is currently the secretary in the Department of Panchayat and Rural Development to the Government of West Bengal. Prior to this, Mr. Sarkar has had a long stint with the MGREG program in the state, and he's done wonders for it there in 7 years of his stay there. He was also mission director with Swachh Bharat, where he has contributed a lot and has been recognized nationally. He's also worked with UNICEF in Calcutta and in Guwahati on social and behavioral change. Mr. Sarkar would be talking to us about barriers and enablers for setting up CSCs based on a study that had been commissioned in West Bengal, and which was done and sometimes in 2015 by Water for People. And he would share what the findings of the study were vis-a-vis community toilets. Our second panelist is Dr. Neelam Singh. She's a practicing gynecologist who has also set up a very vibrant NGO in Lucknow. And she's been running this for the last 25 years. It's called Vatsale. And her focus is on adolescent girls and girl child health, and she works on issues of infant, sex selective abortions, and has been very active in this area. She is a member of the Technical Advisory Group on Menstrual Hygiene Management under the Ministry of Health and Family Welfare. And she's going to talk to us about continuum of support to ensure CSCs address the needs of women. So we bring in the gender angle through Dr. Neelam's presentation. And finally, we have Asad Umar, who is a senior program officer with Officer Wash and Health with the Aga Khan Foundation. He's been in the sector for very many years, has worked with WaterAid and other similar agencies, and he's managed large-scale water supply and sanitation programs. He is also a recipient of the International Fellowship on Groundwater Governance in Asia, and has been awarded, by IWMI. He's going to speak to us on experiences in engaging with communities in UP and Bihar. I would like to invite Mr. Debendu Sarkar as the first panelist. So, sir, you have You have about 6 to 7 minutes to make your presentation, and the rest of it we will take up during discussions subsequently. So we are hoping that the panelists would take about 30 minutes and we still have some time left over for discussions. So Mr. Sarkar, I think we can start with you. You have a presentation. Would you like to? Where is Mr. Sarkar?
Ma'am, I think he's on mute.
Mr. Sarkar, would you like to come in? I think he's on
yes,
mute.
Yes. You're now, on now mute. It's okay. Earlier, it was showing that the host has muted me. So as I said the other day as well, probably it will take a little bit more time than 6 to 7 minutes. Let me see how early.
Sure.
I think so again, host disabled participant screen sharing. So that has to be enabled. Screen sharing has to be enabled by the host.
Achyata Ali, can you just enable the screen sharing please for Mr. Sarkar?
Yes, ma'am. I've just done it. Mr. Sarkar, just
Okay. Let me see. Yes, it's there. Okay. Is my screen visible?
Yeah, it is.
Okay, but yes, full screen. So basically what I'll try to do is very briefly, I'll report on a particular study that we conducted in West Bengal with the help of Watafor people in 2014-15, that particular period of time. In fact, the study was initiated at a time when even Swaraj Bharat mission was not launched. In our state, we had our mission Nirmal Bangla, which is launched on 19th November, World Toilet Day 2013, and which immediately piggybacked on the Swaraj Bharat mission. So when we're doing that mission Nirmal Bangla itself, which was actually part of the NBA, so we requested our kind of wonderful people that whether they can do some kind of a study for us on this particular aspect, the community sanitary complexes. So this is undertaken by them. It was 2014 March, and finally the report came out in 2015. It is a complete survey. Practically what we insisted on is that the all toilets constructed with MNB or earlier TSC funding should be surveyed, and we need to get a specific understanding on how each individual toilet is functioning. So they did that. They used a particular kind of software called Aquaflow. So they used that particular software, and they could ultimately report on 1119 sanitary complexes, which have been kind of constructed under government program, and another 146 complexes, which have been done without any government support. So this is basically part of the community initiative. So that's the background. With that background, they in the study, we decided on certain indicators, like some performance indicators, some financial indicators, and some sustainability indicators. So these are the performance indicators that we talked of, and we decided that each sanitary complex should be seen in the light of these indicators. I'm not reading through the slides, so you can see all these kind of things. Basically, what we thought that there should be how the kind of complexes are distributed across the state, what is the kind of accessibility proposition over there, and what is the sanitary condition, whether hygienic practices are proper or not, whether operation and maintenance is there or not, and solid liquid waste management and its disposal kind of around the sanitary complexes. So these were some of the performance indicators that we thought of. And we also decided on some financial indicators, like whether the fees are collected, that is basically user charges are there or not, whether there's a difference between the fees for male and female, and some kind of an income and expenditure, what is the economics of running a sanitary complex. So that is also there. And then sustainability indicators, naturally, this is more on the basis of the performance indicators and the financial indicators. So what is the collection of tariff or user fee, availability of water, availability of plumber or maintenance worker, presence of caretaker or any other responsible persons. So these ultimately might be helpful in ensuring that the constructions are sustainable. So these indicators were also taken into consideration. So with all these, they did it. So what we found is that if we talk about in terms of distribution of CSEs, the government promoted CSEs, government constructed CSEs under TSC or NBA. So it was there that Purva Medinipur had the maximum 197 and followed by Bakura and Kuch Bihar 114. And this was basically, if you go to the next slide, you'll see that this is uneven distribution. Four of the districts of the state, they kind of constructed 47% of the toilets, whether that remaining 15 districts at that point of time, they constructed 53% of the toilets. So the distribution was uneven. And interestingly, what happened, Kuch Bihar and Bakura, which had very low in terms of kind of IHHL coverage, they had very good kind of community sanitary complexes. So it was not very, it was not like that since people were not using IHHL, the sanitary complexes were taken as an alternative. It is not like that. It's basically they, for some reason or other, they couldn't motivate at that point of time. Later on, Kuch Bihar became a very one of the champions in the country. So whatever it be, at that point of time, it was not there. So they took an easy option of kind of incurring expenditure by constructing sanitary complexes. So that was there. And Purva Medinipur, probably everybody knows that Purva Medinipur, Midnapur in West Bengal was a pioneer in the entire sanitation movement in the country. So Purva Medinipur was good in individual toilets. Purva Medinipur is also the best in kind of complexes as well. So that's basically the distribution. Then we were talking about the accessibility, and what we found that accessibility for daily use was greater in the complexes which have been built with community initiative, not by the government, but beyond government. There, the community kind of accessibility was better. 68% of the toilets constructed were accessible all along. And accessibility was relatively lowered in the kind of toilets that we constructed with the government funding and all. That was 56%. Interestingly, if you look at the district-wise distribution of this, we'll see that Darjeeling had 80% kind of accessibility and Purva Medinipur had 79%. For others, it varied between 50 to even 30. In a couple of districts, it was even less than 30%. Darjeeling, naturally, in the hills, we all know that there is a kind of culture of close quarter defecation. So they were in for the community sanitary complexes as well. And Bindapur, as I said, has a good history of sanitation movement. So they are good in IHHL. They were good in kind of complexes as well. So inaccessibility, we're trying to understand why these toilets complexes are inaccessible. So it was found that 60% of the toilets CSEs are locked. Whatever the inaccessible toilets, out of those 60% are locked, 28% had broken infrastructure, 6% had incomplete construction, and others were different other reasons were there for 6%. So it was like that. And it was interestingly, if we talk about water availability, you'll see that the NBA type means the government kind of constructed toilets. There, 63% didn't have water availability in all the kind of corners, so in all the facilities. But if you talk about the kind of the other part, that is a non-government kind of mechanism, there you will see it 50-50. So that is another interesting feature that came out of the study. So reason for non-access, non-usability, we are also trying to understand. We found that no running water was the maximum kind of contributing factor towards non-usability of the toilets. Then there is an issue of broken fittings, then highly unhygienic condition, and other were there. And if we look, just try to understand how different agencies which constructed the toilets, they contributed. We found that yes, contractors were maximum even in relation to the government or non-government. But interestingly, another interesting feature came that the rural sanitary masts, that's a force to reckon with in West Bengal whenever the toilet issue comes. It is a rural sanitary mart, some kind of a non-government entity, non-government organization, which takes care of construction even in the field of IHHL. Even those kind of community initiatives, the toilets been, they also use the services of the rural sanitary masts. That is why 23% of the toilets constructed even by the non-government actors, they use the services of the rural sanitary masts. So that is also something which came. Then the management structure, we found that yes, 35% of the complexes are managed by the local level committee. There is a local level committee usually kind of developed. and that committee manages the complexes in most of the cases. And in 34%, interestingly, again, a very kind of despairing fact that came out, that 34% of the cases, the complexes have not been assigned to any individual or any organization or anything like that. Those are just constructed and then left. So that is another reason of flaw in the management structure. Then user charges. Yes, the government kind of the NBA and TSC toilets, they were mostly free. 61% of those toilets were given for free. The no user charges were there. Only 39% levied user charges. But if you look at the kind of the non-government complexes, their user charges are more. When at least 64% of those toilets use levy user charges, and those are collected properly. We were also looking at the cleaning agents, who is responsible for cleaning. There are caretakers, there might be hired employees, there might be some cleaning agency, which is pretty low. There might be the local committee. Yes, local committee is responsible for management, but when it comes to cleaning, their role is very limited. SAG members, they were supposed to, we thought that they will be very active in it, but for some reason or other, they were not properly utilized, at least during that particular period of time. And the users were not responsible, and even some of the toilets were not at all clean. So we there is some data that is also there. I'm not getting into these. This is basically the cleaning kind of thing. And hand washing facility and soap, another issue which is very important there, as you all know. So there also we found that the hand washing facility was available in 47% of the kind of complexes done with government support, and soap was not available in 71%. If you look at the other kind of figure, it's a little bit better, not very good, but at the same time a little bit better. So if you look we were also trying to understand the costing, the economics of a sanitary complex. So it was found that if properly run, a sanitary complex can at least be self-sustainable. We found an average surplus of 710 rupees for using a sanitary toilet. So that is also there. And finally, the government support for maintenance, which usually doesn't happen. But again, we found that in 90% of the government constructed toilets, the support is available. And in case of 20% of the community constructed toilets, support is available. So it's not an issue of who constructs, but it's an issue of how the toilets are maintained, and there only the government support goes. So that is also there. So I'll conclude with some of the reflections and observations. Our reflections is, first of all, uneven geographical distribution is always there. No CSC as such, all are public toilets actually. I must say over here that though we are talking in terms of CSC, community sanitary complexes, which will supplement the IHHLs, but in reality, at least earlier, maybe this is the same thing is happening. It is basically public toilets which are being constructed with our coffer, with our funding. Accessibility and maintenance are better when constructed with community initiative that has come out from the report itself. Maintenance is better where user charges are levied. That is also something which you all talk of and which has been substantiated by the study. And without specific management structure, it's difficult to sustain. So that also came. So finally, my observations due to my 6 years association with the program as the state lead over there. So first of all, do we really need one community sanitary complex in each village where there are more than 100 households? Do you really need, if we talk in terms of individual sanitary complex coverage, IHHL coverage across the country, so whether complexes are required, whether people will be paying for maintenance of those complexes, people, their aspiration level has come to such a stage that they will positively be looking for a toilet at the household level and not going out for a community sanitary complex as such. Public toilet may be important, but not community sanitary complexes. So that is there. And should we consider a higher cost norm? Again, my understanding throughout the years, it has come that the kind of amount that we usually spend, say 2 lakh rupees for construction of a community sanitary complex, is not sufficient for having so many seats, for having special separate facilities for men, women, and even the third gender, and for having a bedding facilities and change room and all those things. fund is certainly not sufficient. So a higher cost norm will be required. And since every rural household has access to toilets, probably the focus instead of community toilets, probably we need to call a spade a spade. We might consider kind of public toilets in places of public congregation and with the kind of maintenance, the kind of arrangements that are required there. And finally, everybody is talking about finance commission grants as a safe bet for kind of additional funding. But that coffer is also limited. And the finance commission grants, how those will be spent, that is supposed to be the decision of the concerned panchayat body. So this is some kind of an untied fund. Though we are talking in terms of, say, 20% should be reserved for sanitation and all the water, drinking water and sanitation and all. But at the same time, probably we need to think of certain other areas as well. So I stop over here. If anything has to be, any question is there, I'm ready to take questions later on. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Mr. Sarkar. That was a very interesting presentation that you made. I'm sorry, I think my visual has gone off. Yeah, hello.
I need to switch on
your video. Yeah. I know. I think some, just give me a minute. Something else. Sure. These technical glitches are terrible. Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yeah. We can hear you all along.
I just switch on the video. Also. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. So Mr. Sarkar has really brought out some very pertinent points in his presentation and very fundamental basic questions of whether it's a public toilet or a community toilet that we are eventually constructing and using, whether do we really need one complex for 100 population village, we need to look at it. And what are the cost factors that need to be considered? And maybe a 2 to 3 lakhs increase is not sufficient to take these toilets forward. And to have properly designed and constructed. What one interesting thing which I found he said was that irrespective of who constructs the toilet, whether it is the government or an NGO or a sanitary mart, what is important is how it's constructed and how it is maintained, which means it'll be maintained if the users are really wanting it and using it. I thought these were some interesting things which you could pick up from his presentation. If there are any questions, and I'm sure there are quite a few, I can see there are quite a few questions, we can take this up with him at the end of the session after the other two panelists have made their presentation. Can I request Dr. Neelam Singh to please come on now and to make her presentation on continuum of support to ensure CSCs address the needs of women. Dr. Neelima, over to you.
Am I audible?
Yes, you are.
I don't have Padamja, I don't have a presentation to make. I'll be just speaking. It's just 5-7 minutes, so I'll try my best to
go ahead. Yeah,
accommodate just within this time.
Yeah, sure.
So actually, I'm going to focus, want to take forward from Mr. Sarkar left. And he said, once we have IHHL, why do we need these community complexes? And that's a very pertinent question to be brainstormed. And I feel we have to just look around, how do we position these community complexes? That's very important. Because once we have individual households to have these toilets, so how do we position them? So I feel that we have to, first of all, we have to bring community's ownership, which is very, very important. This has been proved by the earlier presentation also. Once we say O&M after, once they are constructed. So at this stage, this very formative stage, it is very important to discuss with the community, take them on board so that they are with you and they should be positioned in a manner that, you know, in urban areas, when you have guests at home or you have a function or you have people coming in, you will stay in hotels and you have dharamshalas and you have other places so that people can be accommodated comfortably, even for their natural calls in the morning. But we do not have any structure in the rural area and villages to accommodate all of these needs. So can we position them to uplift and to be like in urban you have this facility, what do you have? So would you like to have a structure in the community where all your guests, whether it is a mundan or any other celebration or function in the family, how people, or it is a wedding where all guests and relatives are going to be accommodated. So can we think these structures like that? One. The other is that even if we look at Swachh Bharat Mission and construction of individual toilets, there are roughly, I can say with confidence that at least 15 to 20% of households in every village even now do not have a functional toilet. And they are not going to have one because, you know, either they have had earlier and they cannot be given money from the government side, or there are other reasons why they have not constructed their toilet, or it is defunct. So we can focus on these families. And I think every family, because I have some experience of community toilet construction when Swachh Bharat Mission wasn't there, and the entire issue was there that whenever the girls are going to go to the open fields, they were being sexually harassed, and some cases of rapes also took place. That is how community decided and came along with us for construction of a community toilet when all these girls can safely go, or it is untoward whether they can safely go to their natural calls. So that is how this entire community complex came in, and it was being used. Community was involved right since the beginning, right from identifying the location of the toilet as well as the design and construction. They were taken on board. So they were there, and a sort of committee, as Mr. Sarkar was also explaining, was constructed. So I feel that they should be taken as, because all of us in our families, we want the women to be to preserve their dignity, their values. So I think if we just see these community complexes as place for women, where because, you know, individual toilets are there, but there are no bathing spaces in the households. And especially adolescent girls, when they're growing up and they are taking, they are bathing, they are hardly, in some families, they're hardly bathing because they're bathing within minutes because there is no privacy, private space for them. There is no safe space where they can really have, and you know, when they find a space when they can go, they can use, they can bathe, and they can be comfortable and feel private for themselves. I think these aspects should be taken while we are taking community on board. So this is something which is very important. The other two things which I want to raise here is, one is that, you know, menstrual hygiene management. If you look at even in the individual households in the villages, there are no provision of dustbins, and there is no provision how this menstrual waste will be collected. So as a result, these girls have to, or women, they have to go to the open fields to throw these used menstrual materials, which is, you know, for this they have to either go very early in the morning, they wait for dawn, they do not really sleep, that they can't go during the day, or they go in the evening when it is a little dark. So, and this has a lot of harassment for the girls and women, because even with the provision of individual household, they cannot really look good. So I really believe that these toilets are gender sensitive, and we all know there are a lot of defined norms for gender sensitive toilets. So if we can have good place for disposal of sanitary napkins, which are attached to the women toilet in these places, and there should be good height partition between men and women toilet, so that women can really go and feel safe. And I think the other aspects with, like, safety, water, electricity, maybe electricity with solar panels, and as such we are promoting use of solar. So I think these are the issues which we should be thinking. And they should be, community complexes not only should be seen as toilets, but let's talk of bathing and let's talk of women's dignity around it. And we can start with adolescent girls, and especially focusing on the households in the village where there are no toilets. And we, as I know, there is some provision in the rules of Panchayati Raj Act that people who are found to go to open defecation, they can be punished with punishment. They can be given some financial punishment. So that can be if the families who do not have individual toilet, they are being asked to use these toilets. And they can pay something, user-friendly charges should be decided with the community. And these should be very vibrant, gender-sensitive paintings, maybe aesthetics in a way that promotes the women's uses in these complexes can make use of these toilets, because otherwise, with the coverage of Swachh Bharat Mission, I think there are hardly families who need these community places, and they can be used as, they should be projected as that these are the places which can be used during community events for safe use, and the guests and relatives are not going to go. So that is how the panchayats are taking care of this. And I think there should be someone responsible. In fact, panchayat can be made responsible for upkeeping these toilets. They can decide their user charges. They can decide charges for celebration and events. How much will they be charging? And this money can be used for operation and maintenance of these places. And especially these places can be seen as pride for pride place for women and girls to come and use. Especially, I know a lot of places where individual household toilet is there, but women and girls are not supposed to use them during menstruation. This has come up in many field studies. So can we see these places to be used by women and girls during their menstruation, where they find it a private place to use? They have water, they have privacy, they have place to throw their used materials. So I think, can we see them from this perspective while we are positioning these community toilets? And I think a hand washing area, which Mr. Sarkar also said, is very, very important. And one last thing I would like to say, that you know, ventilation in these, because I've generally seen that the government constructed places are very poorly ventilated, because this ventilation aspect is not the high ventilation points where, you know, the privacy also is maintained. That kind of, because generally toilets are not used because they are not well ventilated, people do not need. And we can think of the location has to be decided well. And I think the committee which is going to look into, in fact, every panchayat should have a committee to decide the operation and maintenance. And this committee should definitely have women and adolescent girls as its members, because probably if when it comes to their own self-esteem and their dignity and a place for them, if they feel the ownership of it, I think we will have some successful stories where women are made in charge of these places. So I think this is what I have to say. I know I have to keep in time. And last thing I want to say, that you know, good advertisement and IC materials, good paintings and materials around, because at times they are made quite far off from the village and then they are not used. So these things are to be kept in mind while we are doing all of this. And lastly, one more place, the as far as the operation and maintenance is considered, at times these materials which are used for cleaning and other materials, they do not find any space, and that is spaces they are stolen every time, and the person responsible says so. We must have a closet or some space for keeping closet or something for keeping these materials, so that the material is always available when the person who is in charge of cleaning goes there. And we can think of Swachhata Karmis which are there in panchayats, and I know these people are not operational and functional, I would say, in a lot of panchayats. So can they be made in charge for this? And I think, of course, the performance indicators and all, monitoring is very important. Who is going to monitor? Who is going to? So all these arrangement and consensus making within the community engagement is very necessary for them to be successful. So I think I tried my best to finish. Yeah.
I know you had to rush through.
I had to rush.
This is a bit of a problem with, I think, when we have time limitations. So I'm sorry, but I'd like to thank you, Dr. Singh, for a very interesting, bringing in a very interesting perspective to the whole issue of starting from fundamentals, that whether do we require community toilets, to going on to talk about the design and its use and maintenance, all structured to address the needs of women and to actually facilitate women. I mean, it's all very relevant to the issue we are talking about. Can I ask Asad to please step in now? And Asad is going to talk about his experience of engaging with communities. It will be, in a way, an extension of what Dr. Singh has been talking to us. So he's going to talk to us about with communities in UP and Bihar. Asad, over to you.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to share my presentation. So I have already shared. Just a second.
Asad, I've shared it for you.
Okay.
So, yeah, I think it's there. We can see it.
Okay. So thank you so much for this opportunity. So my presentation is slightly different than what the earlier speakers have shared. Of course, I would like to take forward from where Dr. Neelima has actually left the discussion. One is, of course, she has mentioned about the importance of operation and maintenance, and also the need to have a sort of committees at panchayat level. So that is something that is really important. I would like to start my presentation from the point that why actually community sanitation complex is actually required. So if you just look at the Swachh Bharat mission, of course, in last 5 years, we have covered a lot of ground. We have improved the overall sanitation coverage. But as Neelima ji has mentioned, that there is still a gap, almost, especially if you just look at the marginalized communities. There are gaps, almost 15 to 20% gaps you will find there. Now, there are these leftover beneficiaries, how they are going to be covered. So for that, there was a requirement. Then in most of the densely populated, I think, villages, there are paucity of land. And also, there are town panchayats or even urbanized villages, and where you will find the migrant or the floating populations, and they need sanitation facilities. Of course, I can imagine from TSC days to Nirmal Bharat Abhiyan till there were provision for community sanitation complexes, but it was really not very, very successful. And obviously there will be, and there must be certain apprehensions around its operation and maintenance. But I think it's a strategic move, and going forward, there could be a sort of possibility if we properly plan it to ensure its sustained operation and maintenance. And that was the reason why actually Government of India has actually prioritized the community sanitation complexes, especially for the migrant population, number one. Number two, in the habitations where essentially we have marginalized populations, because still in many areas they do not have the facilities. And the third point is, if you just look at the policy priority, so a lot of focus has been given to ensure that the accessibility of some community sanitation complexes, how that can be ensured based on the earlier experiences, is it really important? And how panchayats can actually ensure running water facilities and establish, as Neelam ji has mentioned, a sustained operation and maintenance system. Now, I'm going to share, though, Aga Khan Development Network, especially the foundation, works across 6 states of India. But here, I'm going to share some of the experiences from the intervention districts where we are working in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. We have our interventions, and we are closely working with UNICEF and supporting government of Uttar Pradesh, especially in Devipatna division, and also through our network partner Aga Khan Rural Support Program in Bihar, especially in Muzaffarpur and Samastipur. Now, if you just look at the, some of the speakers has mentioned that this was something that was also actually initiated to create a sort of job opportunities. That was one aspect, but yes, all these two states, they have set their priorities. And if you just look at some of the progress, then what we have seen that a substantial number of community sanitation complexes that has already been constructed. as Mr. Devendra Sarkar has already mentioned, that where is the need to ensure that every village after 100 households should have a sort of community sanitation complexes. But here we have slightly different experiences. It is not mandatory actually either in Uttar Pradesh or in Bihar to have these toilets wherever there is a population of 100 households. In fact, in case of Uttar Pradesh, it is the marginalized habitations that has been prioritized. And similarly, in case of, if you just look at Bihar, so communities, because if you just look at Bihar, the Gram Panchayat structure, so almost you'll find 14 to 18 wards in every Panchayat. So at least four community sanitation, four wards were prioritized with population of marginalized communities. Now, if you just look at some of the progress that has been made in the areas where we are working, so almost in Uttar Pradesh, 1200 complexes has already been constructed or nearing completion. Similarly, in case of Muzaffarpur and Samastipur, almost 70% constructions has already been completed. Now, if you just look at the basic structures, I'm not going into the details of this, but yes, it is a sort of basic structures which is being popularized in Bihar. It has a sort of separate provision for men and women with basic amenities of lighting, running water, and of course the availability of soap. This is something that has been prioritized. Similarly, in Uttar Pradesh, three designs have been actually specific designs. Have been suggested for these panchayats. As I have already mentioned, that the priority has been given to the habitations of marginalized populations. Again, in Uttar Pradesh, separate provisions are made for men and women, ensuring availability of water, making provision for pathways to ensure easy access, and provision for ramp, especially for differently abled populations. Now, this is something in terms of existing processes that government should adopt, that guideline mentioned, is first identification of gap, then ensuring a sort of community interaction, then prioritizing the need if at all there is a need, then giving a lot of focus with community participations on the site selection, then involving communities in layout and foundation, then finally, completion of the construction and then handing over of the toilets facilities to communities. Now, we have seen that these processes are there, but still there are lacunas, there are shortcomings. Unfortunately, the entire process is very, very target oriented. And the entire focus is actually around the construction. In few places, ensuring availability of land has been an issue. In many areas, especially in Bihar, because of recurring flood condition, it is really difficult to find the land. The COVID pandemic has actually disrupted the overall progress. The little attention has been given to operation and maintenance. Based on this, actually, what we have prioritized as part of our support to this initiative, how we can actually help based on the guidelines in terms of gap identification. We have organized series of trainings at district level and block level, because we firmly believe that somewhere we really need to strengthen this whole structure at district and block level, so that the required support could be extended to the panchayat. Our focus was to actually orient the district and block functionaries to ensure a sort of participatory approaches are adopted in the villages. We have also given a lot of emphasis to facilitation of the proper site selection, how we can do a sort of accessibility audit, so that at least we can ensure the access to these facilities for the population which is going to use it. Then we have also developed a sort of very dedicated behavior change communication interventions to support districts to popularize the sanitation complexes. And then can we also do a sort of facilitation for operation and maintenance? Of course, these are initial supports. That still everything is in nascent stage. But I think given the overall trend, we are getting some positive trends. And in many communities, especially people have actually, of course, in most of the areas it is not formally handed over, but in certain sections, certain villages, certain habitations where it has been completed for quite some time, people have actually started using it. So we are also actually ensuring a sort of regular visit, supportive supervision, on-the-site training, training local masons, providing IEC materials, facilitating involvement of communities and local panchayats. So these are certain steps that has actually resulted in some positive outcome. And what we have seen actually, two very distinct models are emerging. Now, if we just look at Bihar, so ward level implementation and management committee is something that is mandated to manage these community complexes. But based on our experience, what we have seen that it is it should be and it must be handed over to the user group. Because the families it is meant for, if it is maintained at their level, and we are getting some very positive outcome out of this efforts. Similarly, in Uttar Pradesh, our focus is on one hand to identify, to help identification of user group, doing intensive engagement with these groups. And in fact, one of the factors that usually we've missed out in our SBCC approaches is to train the, because in most of the cases, the community, they are the first time user. So how to train the community as a responsible toilet, for responsible toilet usage and its regular maintenance. That is something that we are trying to actually prioritize. I think district has also requested foundation to support in orientation dedicated to sanitation worker and safai kamis. Again, I would like to mention here that 15 finance commission, of course, it is not enough. There has to be certain provisions, especially for public toilet to get the user charges. But 15 finance commission, especially in places like Uttar Pradesh, there are provision for monthly payment of safai kamis, and that is something we are trying to regularize. These are some of the, in terms of overall opportunities and way forward. So, of course, as I mentioned earlier, that migrant laborers, they got the opportunity to work in initial phase. This has also resulted in the efforts to ensure the involvement of self-help group, especially the SBM team is proactively coordinating with National Rural Livelihood Mission to obtain list of SHGs. And at the moment, we are also helping them to prepare the batches to orient them about operation and maintenance. Provision of soap bank, incinerators, dedicated space for hand washing will definitely promote positive behavior among communities. It is not a sort of very tall ask, but of course, somewhere we are trying to actually, in certain cases, can community sanitation complexes be promoted as a sort of hygiene hub, especially in the backdrop of COVID-19. So this is something that we are prioritizing. The scope of increasing interdepartmental convergence that we have seen, especially NRLM, then of course, Swachh Bharat Mission, Jal Nigam, et cetera, they are talking to each other to actually ensure a sort of proper usage. Increasing involvement of Swachhagrahis in ensuring the use of, because this is a cadre where since last 4 or 5 years, a lot of efforts have gone into their training and their empowerment. So this is something that we are trying to ensure that how we can closely work with the districts to ensure their engagement. Provision of operation and maintenance. So this is something that is different from earlier approaches, that at least now government, the states are not taking a very ad hoc approach as far as operation and maintenance is concerned. There are certain fund provisions for it. Then of course, going forward in big villages, and that is one of the, as I think Mr. Devendra Sarkar has also very categorically mentioned, that public toilet is something that needs a sort of very structured approach for its operation and maintenance. So I think there is a need and requirement going forward to train the panchayats, especially to outsource the professional agencies, especially the urbanized town, for regular operation and maintenance. And those are certain areas where still, especially in many northern states, the panchayats, the block, they need a sort of hand-holding support. So these are certain experiences from our interventions, especially in Uttar Pradesh and Bihar. And I would just stop here, and if there is any questions, I'll be happy to answer them. Thank you.
Thank you, Asad. I think we've almost reached the end of our scheduled time, but we will extend the session by another 15 minutes so that we have time to take up questions, and there are lots of questions that have come in. Since it would be difficult to take up individual questions and respond to them, I've just picked up a few of these questions which are which seem to be pertinent, and we would request the panelists to explain to us if they have any other experience on this regard. And I think the rest of it, we will probably take it up subsequently. We'll give another 5 days more to extend this discussion online. You can respond and write to the to Susanna to and with your ideas, and maybe you'd be able to take care of it. But before that, I'd just like to say thank you to Asad for a very interesting presentation. And I think what this has brought out is it's sort of, in a way, is a foil to the first two presentation, where there was an issue raised as to whether do we need community toilets, and if community toilets are required, are they any different from public toilets? And when Neelam brought in the issue of the gender aspect, and which seemed to, in a way, convince us that toilets are required if for nothing, community toilets are required if for nothing else, at least to ensure that gender issues and social needs in a village, a rural community are taken care of. And Asad has now sort of tried to convince all of us that yes, toilets are required, community toilets are required, because there is still a considerable section of communities in the rural area who are left out because of various reasons, and how we can then go on and try to engage the community, as well as I think the frontline workers, the block level workers, the district and other officials, to actually construct toilets which are usable, workable, and so that O&M and then set up from there on, set up an O&M arrangement which works. So I think it the three presentations has really supported each other. I have some questions have been raised here again I hope one of the panelists will be able to respond to this. One again, coming back to the need for a community complex. One member has asked, is community sanitary complexes a necessity, alternative, or compulsion? I think a lot of this probably has already been answered through the three presentations. And it goes on to say, and will community sanitary complexes address the challenges confronted or triggered by the twin leach pit technology, or will it ensure a status quo? So if I understand this question correctly, I think what the person is trying to, what is being put in here is that obviously the technology and the waste management issues are also of great concern when it comes to community toilets. So how is that being addressed? How the waste would be treated, the waste generated, how that would be cleared, how it would be treated and disposed of, is that being addressed? I'm sure that is being addressed as part of the design, but would either Asad, I think if you can respond to this, it would be good. First of all, that I think we don't need to go into the issue of whether is it necessary or alternative or a compulsion, because I that's been discussed in detail here. So maybe if you could tell us about what is it that you address when you're doing the design of the toilet and when you're looking at how the waste management should be treated? I mean, even for individual toilets, it's an issue. When it comes to community toilets, what are the aspects that one should keep in mind? Asad, you're muted, I think. You need to unmute yourself. While Asad is trying to sort this out, would Mr. Sarkar, would you like to respond to this question about the technical aspects of waste management. I think Asad has not been able to unmute his. I think the host, hello, is there some issue? I think she's probably muted, yeah. Asad, I think we're just trying to work, unmute. I think everybody is being muted.
Asad, you are unmuted.
Yeah. It is now, okay. It is done. So I was struggling. So I think from the host.
That I think was, the host had unmuted.
Yes, yes. No, that's perfectly fine. In terms of technology, definitely there are certain precautions that one need to take. Now, in terms of leach pit, as we all know, this is one of the best technology, but it has its own limitation. For example, it is very good technology for hard rock terrain. It is very good technology for semi-arid or for central India or southern India. But when it comes to gangetic plain, it has its own limitations. So there are certain technological precautions that need to be taken. One is, of course, can we increase the size? Can we reduce the depth? Can we do a sort of bottom sealing? Can we create a sort of buffer zone? So these are certain aspects usually we try to take into consideration. Especially in floodplain zones. But yes, of course, it is not a sort of perfect technology when it comes to the gangetic plain or the floodplain zones. But leach pit, so therefore, in floodplain zones, of course, there are, so site-specific decisions need to be taken if it is a sort of slightly elevated space. If clay contents are more, then definitely we can go for leach pit with certain precautions. But if it is a sandy soil, then of course we have no option but to go for some other options. It could be septic tank, it could be biodigester, etc. But definitely there will be an issue of groundwater contaminations if we still go on with leach pit toilet. In fact, I'll not take much time, but yes, we have also done a sort of very detailed study around it. And maybe through Susanna, I'll be happy to share those findings.
I just have a question to add, and I think which will clarify this the earlier question that was put, is that to what extent do you engage with the community when you're designing the toilet and explain to them the O&M design, O&M options available, and the cost that it would incur. So is that a important part of engagement?
Yes, of course. So this is something as earlier I have mentioned in my presentation, that unfortunately it has become a sort of very, very target driven approach. But yes, in the districts where we are working, in fact, I have also mentioned in the kind of support that we are ensuring at community level. One is to do a sort of participatory planning, to engage communities in terms of prioritizing their need and also to discuss the operation and maintenance issues. So these are certain fundamental aspects. If this is not taken into consideration, I don't think these toilets are going to sustain. And this is precisely what we are doing, trying to do on the ground. This is one aspect in terms of overall maintenance. But yes, in terms of safe disposal of fecal matter, of course, there are technologies right from leach pit to biodigesters to septic tank, etc. And for that, based on the technical input, appropriate decisions are taken and shared with communities.
Mr. Sarkar, this next question is for you. This is someone has asked us that how do community toilets add value in times of natural disasters? Since you've had so many years of experience in West Bengal, where I'm sure you've come across several events where you had to several instances of natural disaster. Could you please share some thoughts on this to us? I mean, it's like how do they add value in times of natural disaster? You're muted. Can you unmute yourself? Yes, that's it.
Now it's possible.
Yeah.
Because someone is kind of muting and unmuting and things like that.
I think so. There's something.
The issue is, yes, the community sanitary complexes that we built in the state of West Bengal were mostly not leach pit or twin pit latrine kind of things. Mm-hmm. These were septic tanks. So that way, being the septic tanks, all IHHs are positively twin pit. But when it comes to community sanitary complexes, these are mostly septic tanks. So that way, the flood issue is to a certain extent and a little bit on raised kind of raised ground. So that flood issue is mostly covered. But the problem of ultimate disposal probably remains. So wherever, even in rural areas, we have say 20 to 30% of the toilets which have been constructed by the people themselves and which are mostly kind of a part of it is septic tank. So for management of the sewerage from those septic tanks, some kind of a policy has been developed. So if that we put into practice, so that would take care of the sanitary complexes as well. That's basically the way we are trying to handle it.
So otherwise, when you're talking about use of these community toilets during time of disaster, have you ever come across that they are actually put into more use because probably the individual toilets are not functional or, you know, because of various reasons when there is a disaster, especially if it's a cyclone or, you know, which strikes that area. So do you find that there is more use of
There are two specific areas where these have been more useful. One is closer to flood shelter. Wherever there's a flood shelter, the sanitary complexes closer to them, to those shelters, were used much more frequently by the people because they didn't have access at home. This is one. And secondly, those which are very close to the embankments. So by the side of the embankments, that is there. But incidentally, there's a question on how we managed those toilets which were found not to be clean, that kind of thing. So basically, after we got that report, it was extensively shared with the districts, and the district tried to kind of bridge the gaps wherever that is there. So that was there. In some of the districts, even they made some kind of a very innovative arrangement of having a stall over there. In front of the complex, which is run by an SHG, and the SHG in turn, from whatever profit they earn from the stall, they use in maintenance of that. So that is also another kind of way in which we try to address this.
Added to this, in fact, somebody answers this question. Especially those of you who are still involved in constructing community toilets, how are you trying to, or are you trying to address a situation like what has been brought about by COVID? I mean, there's so much of distancing required and you know, hygiene, more hygiene of a different kind. So is there any thoughts going into the maintenance and operation and management of community toilets, maybe even the design to some extent, to counter effects of COVID?
Yes, of course. So that is something.
Please.
This is something, unfortunately, I was not able to include those slides because of paucity of time. But yes, that is something we have taken a sort of very conscious approach in order to actually address this whole issue around COVID pandemic. In fact, in terms of design improvisation, in some of the our urban interventions that we have already done, especially in states like Gujarat, and those models we are trying to promote in other locations. In case of rural settings, in fact, back to school preparedness is something we have done. We have done some extensive work in order to secure to provide a sort of very safe and secure environment for children. More or less on the similar aspects, incorporating certain nudges, certain behavioral issues, and also some design improvisation. For example, foot operated or paddle operated hand washing units, for example separation of wash basins, developing a sort of routine schedule of disinfection. So all these aspects are something that we are extensively having discussion with communities, and this is something that we are trying to incorporate. We are also developing a sort of COVID protocol and COVID compliant wash infrastructure protocols. So that is something that that we are trying to share and create a sort of awareness within the community. So that is something is a priority for us.
Mr. Sarkar, you were about to say something. So if you can just tell us in 1 minute.
This is basically, as I said, I'm not directly associated in a COVID situation on this. But right. What we're trying to do at least is do a lot of awareness generation activities on the different hand washing practices and all those things, and which have been built and are being kind of shown around the complexes as well. Because the complexes are places where people congregate. So at those places of congregation that is there, and
hand washing as well. Right. One last question, which Neelamji can answer this. It's asked that would making women in charge of community complexes, would it reinforce the gender stereotypes? Now, that's a question we can go on debating for a long time, but Neelam, if you can just respond.
Yeah, but I said that because of my personal experience of having a community toilet, even when this Swachh Bharat Mission and community complex, sanitary complex was not a focus of government. We built it around because the problem was identified at sexual assault to girls when they were going to the open fields. And in that committee, 50% were the women and adolescents who were in charge of, and they're very careful about the cleaning of the toilets and uses of toilet. Mm-hmm. And that is how this community and collection of the user, they were in charge of collecting the money from user also. So that was a successful model. Based on that experience, I said it. And I believe that as far as cleaning and hygiene is concerned, I think women can understand. And if we tell them the kind of problem which they can face if the toilets are not clean, they affect women mostly, the infections, PID, urinary tract infections. So I think they matter a lot. Women's or participation for these reasons matter a lot.
Right, yeah. Thank you so much. We just have 2 minutes left to end this. So I would just like to flag a couple of issues before we close the session. One is that I think there is, after listening to all the panelists, a lot of our doubts regarding whether should we or should we not go in for community toilets must have been cleared. I would say that it's with quality. Yes, we do go in for community toilets, but with a lot of qualifications and a lot of support. I think that's what comes out majorly from these discussions. It's not because I know there are a lot of people who are totally, not for community toilets and who think it's not necessary and we should go in for more individual toilets. And a number of us who also think that maybe we should take a look at it. I think the maybe should now go a little bit further and see that who needs community toilets, and then engaging those who need community toilets in the process of designing, constructing, and managing. Probably that would be the one would allow community toilets to actually function and show more results. I would just like to add one more bit to this information. I mean, this is just sharing some experience which I had with some of the toilets in urban areas. I found that where community toilets were functioning very well, where community was managing it, there was income being generated to run the toilet. After about 3 to 4 years, the footfalls became less, the number of users became less, and obviously the money coming in became less, and the upkeep of the toilets was also not up to the standard, and it generally falls into disrepair. Now, I think this is a very natural progress, and why this happened was because those who were using community toilets, like Mr. Sarkar said, their aspirations were different now, and each of them wanted their individual toilets. So they had moved in from community to individual toilets. So I think once we are designing and we are looking at the maintenance aspects, this is something which we do need to keep in mind and accept as a natural progression of the purpose of community toilets. With that, I would like to end this session, and I'm so sorry about not being able to take up all the questions and, you know, give more time, but unfortunately that's how this works. So the organizers have indicated that the discussion is open for another 5 days till about the 25th of this month. So if anyone would like to add to the discussion, please send in whatever it is in writing to Nitin and to Nitya, sorry. And we would really pick that up all in the synthesis, which is going to be prepared at the end of this discussion session. So thank you all so much. Thank you, especially the panelists, for very interesting perspectives. And I think three very different perspectives, which enrich the whole discussions. Thank you so much. Thank you, everybody. Goodbye. Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye, everyone. Thank you.
Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Everybody. Bye. Thank you.
Thank you.
Bye, everyone. Thanks for
thanks a lot.
Having me.
Great. Thanks, Asa. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.